Yeah. So let us start today's class. First, I will brief you about the syllabus here completely. And then we will go to the first unit. If time permits, we will start with the first unit. Fine. So I have muted everyone. So please use the chat box here to reply or ask questions or any clarifications. So firstly, the subject name is Business Mathematics and Logical Reasoning. A very interesting subject, because this subject will be repeated in your professional courses if you're taking CA or CS anywhere. Okay, so both CA and CS has this part of the paper along with their subjects. Okay, some part is there. So if you have taken CA or CS, again it will be a little repetition there. So it will make it, you'll be very comfortable to solve the problems and you will have a better understanding of the subject. Fine. So let's see. The first chapter is called Theory of Sets. Here we will be learning what is a set theory. Okay, set is nothing but a small group. Okay, that's a group. Another word for a group is called as a set. Okay, if it is of similar items, usually what happens, group means you will have a different items also being arranged or kept. In a set, it is usually a group of similar items. Okay, so that will be set, and we will be learning about set theory and a little application of Venn diagram. Now, Venn diagram is like, you would have already done in PUC if at all you had taken maths. So you would have two circles where you find the relationship between two things there. Okay, so it's like rain. Okay, then let's take for example. Okay, because of rain, the number of accidents increasing or decreasing. Okay, there's a relationship between the rain and the road accident. If there is too much rain and the water is filled on the road, okay, the vehicles may not move as easily as on the normal road, right? So at those times, there are more chances of accidents happening. So we will use this situation and we are going to represent that in a form of a diagram. So those are called as Venn diagrams. So we'll be learning about Venn diagrams and a little basic concepts of permutation and combinations. So combinations are, permutation combinations are very relatable to the everyday cooking, you can say. Now, suppose you want to cook Maggi. Now, cooking Maggi is very easy. You just keep the water to boil and add the Maggi and the powder, right? Now, you only have limited ingredients there to mix up. So you know which ingredient to put. But suppose you are cooking something else. Let's say you are cooking a pulao. Now in that you have so many ingredients, right? Now in such case, you have to know which should come first, which should come next. All these things are called permutation combinations. Okay, so we are going to learn this in the mathematics basis, and application of this will happen in other subjects also a little. Okay, when you are comparing the business scenario, that time we will use these set theory a little. It will not be a direct implication, but you would be applying them in the further subjects. Okay, and then while the chapters are going on and while we are solving problems, I shall ask you to mark few of the important type of problems which may be asked for exams. So kindly mark those problems and write the marks beside it. I'm not saying only this problem will come, but a similar type of problem may be asked in the examination. Okay, that applies for all the chapters. As in when we proceed in the syllabus, as in when we do one of the other chapters, you will know them. Okay, now that was your first unit, Theory of Sets. Now going to the next unit, it's called Types of Equation and Matrices. Now equations, we have been learning from school, okay, quadratic equation, linear equation, we would solve certain problems, simultaneous equations. If you have not taken maths and PUC, do not worry. We are going to learn everything in detail over and again. If you have learned, it will be a revision and it will be easy for you. For those who have not learned, I'm here to help you out. Okay. So types of equations, we will learn linear equations. In that, methods are there, simultaneous equations. Then you'll have quadratic equations. And how do we apply the equations in business and management? See, this forms a very important part. Okay, it's a very important part of your business mathematics. That is why this subject, especially business mathematics, is added to your syllabus. Okay, today in day-to-day life, whenever you get into any job or you start any business, okay, who knows, tomorrow you might start any new business. Now, for such business also, if you have the basic idea of all of these things, it would be helpful. Okay, you would be applying this, but not very consciously. You would not say, okay, I'm going to apply equations now and solve this problem. You would not say that, but you would be doing it unknowingly in a day-to-day life. Okay, so we are going to learn what are the applications of equations in business and management. There's a very big application which we will be learning. Then coming to matrices is a separate concept. We'll be learning that, and basic of matrices like addition of matrix, subtraction of matrix, multiplication, division. These are the basic calculations of matrices that we will be learning. Along with that, we will also learn inverse of matrix and certain problems on linear equations. And one important thing in matrices is Cramer's rule. Okay, Cramer's rule is important, which for sure a question will be asked in the examination. So we are going to solve the problems regarding Cramer's rule. So these are the first two chapters of your business mathematics and logical reasoning. Okay, any doubts until here? I want everybody to reply in the chat box. Okay. Let's continue. Let's go on to the next chapter. The next chapter would be ratio and proportion. And then along with that, you have percentage, profit and loss. This is actual part of business mathematics. Okay, while doing business, how do you share the profit? All of you have learned accountancy, right? Some part of accountancy you have learned, yes or no? You have learned accounts and you have heard about partnership accounts. Now in partnership accounts, there's this famous problems which comes all the time. A and B are partners. C is admitted into the firm for 1/4 share. A and B share profits in the ratio of 2:3, 1:6. Yes? All these we use ratios. In all of these cases, we use ratios. Okay? And then, goodwill. Calculation of goodwill in the partnership. Okay. C has got 15,000 rupees towards goodwill. Goodwill is being shared by old partners A and B in the ratio of 3:1. See, we have already used ratios and proportions so much in our pre-university level only. Okay. So here we are also learning what are the different types of ratios, what are the other application of ratios and proportions. Proportions is also related to ratio, but on a higher level. Okay. Now in this, you will have properties of proportions, types of proportions, and how do we calculate ratio and proportions. And then we have calculation of percentage and how the percentages is calculated for marks. See, very, very important. Once you finish one semester, You will be asked what is your result, and then you're supposed to calculate your percentage from that basic level of application till the higher level of economy application. We use percentages, right? You would have heard about GDP, okay? And they say so much percentage of GDP, and then export is this percentage, import is this percentage. Okay, there's lot of application of this in the day-to-day life, which we ignore. We don't actually concentrate so much on them. So all that we are going to learn here as a concept. Then profit and loss calculations, very much implied in every business. Every day, how much we are spending, how much we get profit. We usually calculate. If you have a small business, or if even if you have invested somewhere, we usually calculate the profit or loss. Then calculation of cost and selling price. This is very, very interesting topic, because cost price is different, selling price is different. Okay. Now, suppose if I manufacture one mobile phone, now for that one mobile phone would cost me, let's say around, it is costing me 5,000 rupees for manufacturing. Now, will I sell the mobile phone at 5,000 rupees? Will I do that directly? I manufacture my mobile phone at 5,000 rupees. Will I sell it at 5,000 only? So what do I add to that mobile phone manufacturing? What do I add to that? Any idea? Now that 5,000 rupees I have in hand. Yes, very good. Profit. So I add profit along with 5,000. Let's say I am adding another 3,000 rupees. Okay, making charges. Rida, making charges are only the manufacturing charges. Okay. Making charges are only manufacturing charges. This making charge, what you're talking about, will come only in the gold. Okay. Why they come in that gold and silver? Because gold and silver are raw materials. And one person has to sit there and, you know, do a lot of procedure to convert that gold into a beautiful ornament. So that is why making charges. Okay. But for a mobile phone, manufacturing cost, okay, or this cost price itself is the making charge. And for that, we add the profit. Now, once we add the profit, it will become selling price. Okay, so that profit, whatever I'm adding, in my example, it is 3,000. That is the profit which I'm adding. And that profit will come to me once I sell the mobile phone. Okay, so we're going to calculate all the cost price and selling price. Now, there are formulas for cost price. There are formulas for selling price, which we'll be learning. Not too complicated, very simple, basic mathematics are given. Okay, now here... and they're also giving us a little more information about different articles. How do we sell different articles, and at what rate should we sell? Okay, so these are types of calculation for you to understand when you're buying or selling a product. And MRP, yes, that is maximum retail price. That is the highest price at which I can sell the product. Okay, if I sell above that MRP, then it is a it's an offense in the country, because there is a rule that you should not sell anything above MRP. Okay, so that is your unit 3, ratio, proportion, percentage, profit and loss. Okay, any doubts in unit 3? Any more clarification you require? Okay, let's continue. Now, coming to the next chapter, interest and annuities. Now, we would have bought a loan. At home, they would have taken a loan, okay, from the bank. Now, for that loan, we have to pay interest. Now, how do we calculate that percentage of interest? Okay, how do we calculate the amount of interest? That is the interest calculation. And then we would have kept a fixed deposit, FD in a bank. Now, how do bank calculate the interest for our FD? That is also the calculation of interest. Okay, we would have bought a new TV at home. on EMI basis. Every month we would pay some particular amount to that shopkeeper. Okay? Or we would have bought a refrigerator at EMI, AC at EMI, mobile phones at EMI. Now every other product you can buy at EMI. Now this EMI, there is an interest which you're supposed to pay. How do we calculate all that interest rates? Okay, so that is your interest and annuity. So we will be calculating simple interest, compound interest for 1 year, half year, 6 months, 1 week, 1 day, half day. Every other calculation you can do using this interest. Okay, then apart from these implication interest, you will also calculate percentages here of interest for investment. Okay, you have invested somewhere and how much profit you would get back, that also you can check. Okay, now today you are investing 100 rupees in a bank. Okay, today you are investing 100 rupees in a bank. After 1 year, that 100 rupees will grow, yes or no? If you keep 100 rupees in a bank account, will 100 rupees grow or it will not grow in a bank account? It will grow, right? Now, how it will grow? Bank will keep giving you the interest amount. Okay, bank will keep adding to the interest amount. So, 100 rupees you keep today, every month or whenever they calculate interest, they keep adding that interest amount for your 100 rupees. And after 1 year, let's say your 100 rupees has grown to 150 rupees. Okay, so 100 rupees has grown to 150 rupees. So we are going to find out the present value of that amount and the future value of that amount. So present value is 100 rupees and after 1 year, what will be the amount? That is future value, which is 150 rupees. Okay, so that is the calculation of net present value and future value. And then coming to the next concept is annuities. Now here annuities means every annually or every 1 year, every year when you start paying the amount, it will become the annuity. Okay, it's a different concept, a beautiful concept which is implemented everywhere. Especially banks use all of this. So tomorrow if you start a business and you want to take a loan, which type of loan you want to take? What is the procedure of the loan? Not the documents. I'm talking about the loan interest calculation procedures. Okay, all that, these interest and annuity calculations, basics will be implemented. And upon that, you have many things else. Okay, but these are the basics that you have to understand to know the percentage. Okay, so these are the first four chapters. Any doubts until here? Okay, now coming to the fourth unit, the most interesting part of the subject, which is called logical reasoning. Okay, now here logical reasoning is you have to just think logically according to the question given to you. Okay, according to the question given to you, you have to think logically and answer. You are not expected to use any of your previous knowledge. Okay, now you would have certain beliefs about the situation, right? You should not use any of that in the logical reasoning. Here only they will give you the question. Reading the question or understanding the question, whatever answers you can derive from it, you have to say. So for logical reasoning, you have number series. You have coding and decoding. You would have seen in a few question papers which comes in the newspaper or online also. You will have certain diagrams with lines. They will ask you how many triangles are there? How many squares are there? Have you come across such questions? How many triangles are there in this picture? Okay, how many dots are there in this pictures? Yeah, we would usually see that on social media also. Okay, your Facebook will be filled with all such questions and they always say whoever answers this is a genius and all that. Everybody is a genius. We are going to work all sorts of problems like that. Okay, so that will be coding, decoding, time and work. You will have reasoning, relationship. Relationship, it usually happens at, talks happens at home. Like my mother's brother's daughter's husband. Now you will have to find the relationship between you and that person. Okay, so such, that was an example though. Okay, such are relationship problems. They're very interesting to solve. You will not know, how time goes with all those, but you'll enjoy solving all those problems. And syllogism also is something which is related to reasoning part. You have to give reasons. You have to think logically. Okay, don't use any previous, knowledge that you have in logical reasoning. What is given in the question, apply that and solve. Okay, so that is your final unit. Logical reasoning, there's a numbering mistake. It's unit 5 and not 4. Okay, so these are the 5 units that you have in the syllabus. Okay, we will also be doing a lot of activities along with this in between. Not only problems all the time, but we'll also do certain activities. Fine. And now coming to the notes part. So please maintain a separate notebook. 200 pages would be enough. For now, if required later, you can add up another book. So ruled, unruled is up to you. Okay. If you are comfortable writing in ruled, take ruled. If you are comfortable with unruled, go for it. We will be solving more problems firstly. So every day, whatever problems we solve has to be written in the notes. And extra questions will be provided for you to solve on a daily basis. Okay, do not keep that pending. Okay, do not keep that pending. Try and solve them on the same day. It has to be completed on the same day in the classwork only. I'm not asking you to keep a separate book and write. In the classwork only, you have to solve. And every week, yesterday we started with the classes. Okay, that's Monday. So let's say this week by Saturday, I will ask you people to submit your notes for correction. Now, submit your notes for correction means you need not come to college. Okay. Everybody, please install an app called Adobe Scan. Okay. Adobe Scan. I will send a small video onto the WhatsApp group on how to use this Adobe Scan app. Fine. And you are supposed to use that Adobe Scan and scan the complete notes and send it to me. Okay. So that is how we do the corrections. For now, until we start the physical classes. Okay, but there is no information about physical class yet. So we will let you know slowly. Okay, any doubts until here? Anything you want to say? Anything you want to clarify? Everybody understood? So this is first chapter, theory of sets. Now here, in this first chapter, we will understand what is sets first. Now, once we understand what is sets, later we will be analyzing or understanding what are the different types of sets and everything. Okay, so first, sets. In our mathematical language, everything in this universe, okay, is called an object. Living, non-living, doesn't matter. Okay, in mathematics, everything in the universe is called a object. You are an object. I am an object. Your mobile phones are object. Books are objects. Pencils are objects. Okay. So a very familiar and a constant term used is that anything in the universe, if it is living or a non-living thing, everything is called an object. Okay. Now, this is the definition which is required to understand set. Now let's see what is set. A set is defined to be the collection of well-defined distinct objects. This collection may be listed or described. We will understand this with an example, so that will help you to understand it better. Okay. Now see the first example. A is equal to, you have a flower bracket. Okay. So open a flower bracket. You have A, E, I, O, U.
Can anybody say me what is this AEIOU? What do we call them as? Vowels. Great. Very good. No. Anusha, they're not articles. They're vowels. Okay. Articles are A, an, and the. Okay. So these are vowels. So A, E, I, O, U are vowels. Now this A, E, I, O, U are a set. Okay. This A, E, I, O, U are a set. Now, how do we go about, how do we describe this as a set? It says that a set is a defined, it's defined to be a collection of well-defined distinct objects. Now, we can easily say it is a group of vowels, right? So, that is why this is called as sets. Next, let's take another example here. B, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Now, can anybody say me, how can you call this 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 generally? Even numbers, very good. So, it starts with 0, they have not added 0. So, here it just starts from 2. Okay, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, where you have 2 and 10 included. So, this is a set. So, it's well defined that it is together. So that is what is called a set. Now for your class, okay, I can say a set of students of BBA SEM 1. Okay, so all of you together will become a set of students who belong to BBA semester 1. Okay, so that is called a set. Okay, did you all understand what is a set? Any doubts? Fine, let's continue. Now we understood what is a set. Okay, this may be listed or described. Now what is listed? Listed means I write it like this. A, E, I, O, U. I write it separately. Or I write the numbers. 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Now if you see here D. 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. I'm writing the odd numbers, right? So these are listed. Now when it comes to described, described means instead of writing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 2, 4, 6, 8, I write them in sentences. Now in sentences, what happens for A? Now just see here. A is A, E, I, O, U. Now instead of writing A, E, I, O, U, I will write them as the set of vowels in the alphabet. So I am describing what is there in that set. Okay. Now for the even numbers, the set of even numbers between 2 and 10. I am giving a border. Okay. I start from 2 and I end at 10. Both inclusive. So I am adding 2 also. I'm adding 10 also. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. I have so many even numbers between 2 and 10. Okay, so this is descriptive form and this is listing form. Fine, so that is your set which may be listed or described. Now going on further, each object is called an element of set. Now this A, small a in particular, is an element of set. E is another element of set. I is another element of set, O is element, and U is element of set. So each of them is called element of a set. Same thing which goes with even numbers. 2 is an element, 4 is an element, 6 is an element. Like this, there are elements. Okay, next. We usually denote sets by capital letters and their elements by small letters. Now, what are they trying to say is, if you see here, you have capital A, capital B, capital C, capital D, and capital E. So, when you're denoting, these are called denotions. When you're denoting, you use capital letters, but inside them, inside the elements, all these elements are denoted in the small letters. Now, same thing you see here. These are also elements with the combination of P, Q, and R. Okay, P, Q, and R is written in different combinations here, placing them at different places. Okay, so these are usually small in letter, but denotions always should be in the capital letters. Okay, so that is sets. I hope this is clear. Anybody has doubt? Now, the last point here. Okay, the last point here, let's just understand. Okay, someone raised the hand. 1 second. Just hold on. Okay, let's finish up this last point here. Okay, then this form is called roster or braces form. Now, why it is called roster form? Because you're separately giving details of every element of set. So that's why it's called roster form. And braces. Braces is nothing but brackets. Okay, so you have brackets here, flower brackets. Okay, you open, you write the elements in between the flower brackets. In this form, we make a list of elements of the actually there's a spelling mistake here, of the set, and put it in within the braces. Braces are these flower brackets. Use flower brackets for sets. Don't use other type of brackets. Okay, use flower brackets only for the sets. Okay, so these are the first definition of a set and a few example, and this type of listing is called as roster or braces form, where we use the flower bracket and write the elements of set inside them. Okay, so any doubts? I'll just stop the sharing. 1 second. Wait a minute. Okay, I hope everybody understood. That's nice. So we will meet in the next class and I'll share the notes. Please copy down the notes now and we will continue in the next class. Okay. Thank you, students.